Hello friends, welcome back to our Engineering Today. As you're looking for some latest updates, we'll present two updates for you. First, probable SpaceX Dragon debris in Australia, and then we'll look upon swarms developments along with SpaceX. Today we'll begin with space debris falling in Australia. Is it SpaceX's? That remains a question. Recently, a massive space debris chunk has been discovered in the rural part of Australia. According to reports, some sheep farmers in Australia have found a massive chunk of rocket debris in the middle of a sheep paddock near Dalgety of southern New South Wales. Sources state that on the 9th of July, a bang was also heard at 7:05 a.m. in the area prior to this discovery. The experts were guessing that the charred piece of space waste was from a SpaceX Dragon craft that re-entered Earth on July 9th and crashed in some places of the country. On the 25th of July, Mick Miners, a sheep farmer in Dalgety, had first noticed the 9-foot-high debris in his paddock. Another farmer, John Wallace, had spotted more debris on his property the previous week. Jonathan McDowell, a space debris tracker, first hinted on the 29th of July that the space debris which landed in Dalgety was actually a part of Dragon's spacecraft from Crew 1 mission that was jettisoned before re-entry. McDowell had further stated, after seeing photos of the debris, that the crashed piece came from one of the trunk fins that help in maintaining the aerodynamics of the spacecraft during launch. But till now, SpaceX didn't confirm whether that debris belongs to Dragon or not. Brad Tucker, an astrophysicist who had himself visited the crash site, stated that, "Having gone out there and looked at the bits myself, there's not a doubt in my mind it's space junk." Tucker also specified that the debris was most likely the unpressurized trunk of the Dragon spacecraft. "Having looked at it myself, the way it is manufactured, and the material is clearly of an advanced manufacturing, this wasn't done in someone's shed. You can see clear scorching marks from re-entry," he said. Tucker also mentioned that the time of sonic boom and structure of debris makes it very close to the tracked path of the SpaceX One crew trunk. As per sources, the trunk of Crew Dragon is developed to send unpressurized cargo into space and also to support the Crew Dragon during its launch. The trunk also contains solar panels that power the Dragon capsule. Before re-entry, this trunk detaches from the main capsule, and it seems that Tucker is hinting towards it for the debris. Reports state that Tucker had found one part number on one of the charred pieces and has asked for SpaceX to confirm if this matches the trunk of Dragon. And if the number matches, then this would be the largest recorded piece of space debris to fall in Australia after Skylab's uncontrolled re-entry over Western Australia back in 1979. The discovery of debris took a long time as the pieces had spread over a very large area. According to Tucker, "From a distance as well, it looks like an old burnt tree stump. It wasn't until you got closer you realized there's something off about it." Both farmers thought it had been there a few weeks based on the last time they would have gone nearby. Sources state that if Dalgety debris belongs to SpaceX Dragon, then it would not be the first case for SpaceX, as earlier in 2021, debris from a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket had showed up on a farm in central Washington. Yet that probable SpaceX debris would be comparatively much smaller than the 100-foot-long Chinese rocket junk that disintegrated in the Indian Ocean very recently. Last Saturday, the U.S. Space Command informed about the uncontrolled re-entry of Chinese Long March 5B rocket, which took up the second main module for their new Tiangong space station. Parts of the 23-ton rocket booster had splashed in the Pacific Ocean near the island of Palawan in the East Philippines. Bill Nelson, administrator of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, or NASA, slammed China for its irresponsible space junk deposit. He said, "All spacefaring nations should follow established best practices and do their part to share this type of information in advance to allow reliable predictions of potential debris impact risk, especially for heavy lift vehicles like the Long March 5B, which carry a significant risk of loss of life and property. Doing so is critical to the responsible use of space and to ensure the safety of people here on Earth. Now let's take a look at how Swarm is going after being acquired by SpaceX. We know that SpaceX had acquired Swarm Technologies almost 10 months ago, and after this brief period of time, Swarm faces a leap in their progress. In the last 10 months, Swarm has seen rapid acceleration, says Sarah Spangallo, CEO of Swarm and presently Senior Director of Satellite Engineering at SpaceX. SpaceX's acquisition is practically a boon for Swarm, and Spangallo herself confirms that. Earlier lack of speedy deployment and growth of their tiny Internet of Things, or IoT, satellite had been a major blockade. But with SpaceX's super-fast launch capability, Swarm is getting a major benefit in launch cadence after acquisition. Spangallo said, "Access to basically free launch is pretty exciting. We actually have launched probably 3 or 4 times, and we now have over 160 satellites in LEO. Being very small in size, Swarm satellites have a good advantage of getting in any ride on SpaceX launches meant for other customers, and that's why the launch number increases." She also mentioned the experimental satellites that have also been launched with the Internet of Things satellite. She said, "That's a pretty important threshold. If you're doing any sort of monitoring, whether it's floods, water, forest fire detection, agriculture applications, logistics applications, that's like a pretty important threshold in that community. That's unlocked a bunch of exciting new use cases and customers." Spangallo stated that connections with SpaceX have helped Swarm to access just more support systems regarding legal, accounting, HR, recruiting, logistics, supply chain, and production. This has helped Swarm to speed up their production rate, as well as providing a good boost in recruitment of employees. Spangallo said, "We've been scaling up and will probably do 10 times the number of devices sold this year versus what we did last year." While Swarm is benefiting from SpaceX, the aerospace company too has some benefits from Swarm. As Spangallo confirms, "We're also supporting SpaceX in a bunch of ways, from engineering and technology and regulatory strategies to lots of other programs that hopefully we get to talk about in the future. We are definitely having product discussions across the chasm that is Starlink broadband to Swarm IoT and everything in between. And the roadmap really fills in a lot of the gaps between those things that you've been hinting at. Certainly, on the enterprise side, we've started to engage with some of these same enterprise customers. You can imagine big agriculture companies or oil and gas or maritime companies that have a need for broadband, as well as for satellite IoT. So we've definitely been able to benefit from those mutual relationships, really both ways. Some Swarm customers are interested in Starlink and vice versa."
Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.